Salut tout le monde, c'est Dr. Rudolf Maurice. Nous vous souhaitons bienvenue dans le programme Soins et Santé, qui est un programme d'éducation pour la communauté noire. Aujourd'hui, nous avons Phyto Institute, son clinique côté si on est enceinte et puis on a un problème avec petit bébé dans le ventre. Eh bien, il vient voir ici là et puis docteur a corrigé problème là sans pas faire gros opération, sans pas couper ventre là. Il fait opération en dents. Donc son problème qui très populaire bon ici là côté mounio le petit mounio enceinte mais il est enceinte avec jumeaux ou bien donc il y a un problème en dans votre là donc ça c'est un gros problème et docteur Sayo inventé une procédure côté yo aller yo pas besoin ouvrir votre là yo prend aiguille et puis entrer et puis avec un laser et puis yo corriger problème là donc nous parlons interview de docteur bon ici là je veux dire là qui docteur Kontapoulos avec Dr. Quintero qui pourra expliquer nous et pour qui ça y entre le fil ça et qui ça exactement que vous fait. Donc, retenons tout à l'heure, nous venons tout à l'heure. Salut tout le monde, c'est Dr. Rudolf Maurice. Nous avons souhaité un nouveau show qui est Soins et Santé. Jeudi, nous avons avec nous un docteur, un spécialiste spécial. Ça lié son docteur qui spécialise le fait opération le monde qui est enceinte, mais sans qu'il n'y ait pas ouvert l'estomac. La science fait pile pour le kounia là. Donc, kounia là, on a besoin d'opération, ça y est, pas besoin de couper le ventre encore. Il entre directement avec les aiguilles et puis il fait opération en dents. Votre maman sans pas couper votre monde. Donc, je vais vous introduire Dr. Kontapoulos, qui est un professeur à l'Université de Miami, et il fait ça combien d'années? Good afternoon, Dr. Kontapoulos.
Good morning. How are you?
Great. When I went to medical school years ago, we didn't have all these technology where you can do certain procedures in vitro and so on. You had to actually go around and do the C-section and do that and so on. Now I understand that you have a lot of advancement. Can you explain to the audience exactly how you got interested into this field in the first place?
Yeah, so the reason we, you know, there's so much change in technology, as you mentioned, over the years. And originally, in the old days, people just would listen to the baby or touch the mother's belly and make diagnosis. Now we have so much more progress. We have high tech technology, ultrasound that we diagnose very accurately what's happening to the mother and the baby. Sometimes there's these diagnoses that are very serious and very severe for the baby. And we know that unless we help the baby before the baby's born, it won't have a good outcome. So there are ways nowadays to do surgery on the fetus before the baby is born, and also with having good results for the baby and good results for the mother. Being able to change the diagnosis and from a mother who's very worried and very anxious, telling her bad news, to be able to give her some hope that the baby will be better and we can change the diagnosis, that is major for me. That made me get into this field because I wanted to be able to change, bring happiness, bring a smile to the patients. So for example, there are many times where a mother is told on ultrasound when they see the baby that the baby has a very, very bad diagnosis. For example, it could be a tumor in the fetus when the baby is, let's say, 20 weeks or 22 weeks. It could be a diagnosis with the baby's heart. It could be a diagnosis where there's twins and they have problems being in the same environment and feeding off the same placenta. For example, twin-twin transfusion syndrome. That's one of the most common diagnoses. Well, if I have the ability to be able to change that and tell this mother that we can save these babies and give them a good outcome, a good opportunity for them to be healthy and to live and have a good life after that, that is major, and that's the reason I went into this field.
This is exciting, and I assume your mother as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I'm in this dual role. You know, I'm a surgeon, I'm a physician, and I'm also a mother. So I can see things from both angles. You know, it puts me closer to the patient. So when many times we tell the patient, you know, this is what's happening, this is happening with the baby, and I put myself in her shoes. And sometimes they ask me, well, what would you do? And it puts me very close. I understand completely the worries of the mother. many times, though, when you're in that dilemma of not knowing what to do next, you hear a diagnosis that the baby has something, an ultrasound, and many times these patients have no hope. They have nowhere to turn. They just only wait and see what's going to happen. But that's where we come in, because sometimes if there's a bad diagnosis, we can say, look, there is hope. There is a chance. Sometimes these procedures have success of up to 90% of a good outcome. And there's hope that we can change things and have a healthy baby.
So before that, you used to wait after the baby is born to operate, but now we can do it while the mom is pregnant. Does it really make a difference?
Yeah. So if there's a diagnosis that won't change and the baby can do good in utero, you know, throughout the pregnancy, and wait until we have the surgery after birth, then we wouldn't, you know, touch that baby. We just follow this patient very carefully and make sure the baby's okay until delivery. But there's some times when these babies need help before they're delivered. They need help before they're born. There's some babies that have a problem with their lungs, with their diaphragm, or they may have problems with the fluid around them that doesn't allow them to breathe very well when they're born. So these cases where we know that the baby, although it looks okay, quote unquote, but the baby may have a problem at delivery, these are the babies that need surgery before they're delivered. That's the big difference. And now we have a way to do it. And we've been doing this for the last almost 20 years, and it has very good success rates for these specific cases. If we see that the baby does not need surgery, we won't touch it. But it's very important to be able to know and answer the questions for the patient. And these mothers come with many, many questions. They read things about the diagnosis, you know, they hear from their friends, they go to Google, they hear from other doctors, and they come with many questions, and sometimes they're misinformed. So it's important to know what are the options.
And you see patients from all over the world, not just Miami.
Yes, we see a lot of our referrals. I have to say almost 50% of our referrals are from even outside of Miami, outside of the United States. A lot of patients come from the Caribbean, Latin America, even other countries from Europe.
Have you operated on any type of any Haitian patients?
Yes.
You have?
Yes, we have. Actually, we have. Well, I don't want to, you know, say specifically about those patients, but in general, you know, I think that culturally, a lot of these patients, because they have big faith, they want to know exactly, you know, what is the outcome going to be. And I think once the patients that I've had have been very, very trusting in our hands, and they've been very, very happy afterwards. They actually, some of them come and find us now after the babies are already 4 and 5 years old, still come and see us. And, you know, we see the kid and the healthy kid, and it's very rewarding to see the result of a baby doing well when she was told originally that your baby's not going to do well. She was told the worst things, crying, and then now we have a healthy baby. I mean, that's the most rewarding thing.
It's very special. You also work with your partner, Dr. Quintero. Mm-hmm. How do you do together, or do you alternate the surgeries?
Yeah, so we see the patients here in our office. Coral Gables, we do all the evaluations separately most of the time. Each of us see different patients, and each of us does surgeries on their own. We're both, you know, trained to do these fetal surgeries, and he actually is the one who has developed some of these surgical techniques. But there are times where some of these cases are so complicated that we actually both in the operating room, and we need both to be there and collaborate and do the surgery together, and even sometimes brainstorm, because some of these are they need as much assistance as possible. It's great to work together, and it's great to have two experts together working on a case.
How long does it take? I know it depends on the case, but average, an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours?
Yeah, most of these cases, because they are done with very small instruments, I'll explain, they usually take an hour and a half. They're done with instruments that are specifically made for these procedures. We use very small instruments. I usually tell my patients, like a tip of a pen. The incision is very small. It's only less than a centimeter. And we go and we take a look inside the uterine cavity. We go and specifically see everything, all the geography, where the placenta is, the fetus is. Everything is done endoscopically, so minimally invasive. And a lot of patients ask me, am I going to have a big incision? Are you going to cut me open? No, it's all done through a small port of less than 1 centimeter. These patients are usually kept in the hospital only for a day. We see how the fetus is doing the next day, and they usually are discharged. I think an important point is also that, and a lot of my Haitian patients actually ask me this question, do you going to put me to sleep? Do I need general anesthesia? And the answer is no. We only do local, and we just give a little bit sedative through the anesthesiologist, just to calm the patient down a little bit, and it's expected. But the good thing is, does not need general anesthesia, does not need epidural. Rarely we would use that.
And the insurance cover the cost of the procedure?
Depending on, you know, which insurance each patient would have, that would have to be tailored specifically. But yeah, these are considered now, most of them are considered cases that have codes, and the insurances are aware of them. Although they're very advanced, but still a lot of them are considered standard of care.
If the patient does not have any insurance, somebody flying from Haiti or from Jamaica or the Cayman Islands, they said, I don't have any insurance, but I want to pay cash. What is the average cost, or at least they're ready to do that?
Yeah, the average cost depends on each procedure differently. But, you know, we work with a billing department that has tried many times to help patients like that.
Okay.
You need to give a special price, or sometimes even a credit program, so they can, you know, adjust. Because in the end of the day, we want to help the patient. It's not about, you know, focusing on that. It's helping their babies. And sometimes we even have, you know, sort of charity foundations that help also these patients find a way to come to us. So, you know, for me, it's about the patient and her baby first. It's about helping this new life, helping this family. And everything else, you know, we can work things around and see how we can make it possible.
Anybody else in Miami or in South Florida does that besides you and Dr. Contrero?
No, actually, we're the only ones that do this here. And, you know, it's a very complicated procedure. You have to be trained. You have to do OBGYN first, maternal fetal medicine, and then be trained to fetal surgery. And we're the only two here that actually do these procedures. And we've been doing them for quite a few years.
Wow.
Yeah.
You must be good at what you do.
I think so. My patients think so.
Okay, today we have with us Dr. Kontopoulos, who's a partner from the Fido Institute in Coral Gables. Do most patients welcome these procedures, or maybe because of their religious belief that they have, you know, hesitant about it?
Actually, I think that some of them come with hesitancy and thoughts when they come before they see us, from things that they are worried about, from things that they have originally given from the diagnosis. But once we explain to them and sit down and do the ultrasound and do the counseling, a lot of them actually are the first ones to say, I want to do something to save my baby. And I think that actually we have patients from all religions, all faiths, but many times they feel like, you know, here's the water, but I have to also do something to drink from the water. So this is a way to actually, you know, do something to help yourself. There's an opportunity to do something to help the baby. And, you know, from there on, it's all God's will in the end, how things will go.
Jehovah's Witnesses, you know, they are very, they have the beliefs. Is that a procedure that they accept? Or
You know, I think that's, we've had people that have been of that religion also. And I think that it's very important to counsel specifically because they have specific questions about certain, you know, let's say the blood or so forth, specific questions that we sit in down and explain each one at length. So, you know, we don't say no to that, but they need to know exactly what is the prerequisite.
Okay. Is there anything that you can assure us at this time, or would you should we ask your partner to talk more about these procedures?
Sure. I think that, you know, both can give you very good information. Okay. I just want to say that, you know, most of these procedures, the good thing is we believe in the first, like my first dogma is first no harm. This is what you know that we learn in medical school, but sometimes it's very important to remember that primum non, it's like do not harm. And we don't do any procedure unless it's absolutely necessary. But if I feel that this person is here and we can do something to save their baby, we'll do everything possible to save this baby and this new life.
Excellent. Well, Dr. Kantopoulos, I thank you for the great information that you give us. And I'm pretty sure our viewers would benefit from this.
Thank you.
Second interview is Dr. Ruben Quintero from the Fido Institute, and he's going to give us a little bit more specific about what they do at the Fido Institute. Dr. Quintero, I appreciate, I know you're very busy, doctor. I appreciate the time that you're spending with us to educate the population about what you do and the wonderful things that happens as a result of this. So can I ask you, how did you get into this field in the first place?
When I was doing my training as a maternal fetal medicine specialist, we were learning how to use ultrasound to make diagnoses of fetal disorders, problems with the baby in utero. But when we found a problem, there was not a solution that we could offer to the patient. So I took it upon myself basically to try to develop a way to treat babies before birth to help alleviate some of the conditions, some of the disorders that we were making a diagnosis of with ultrasound.
And what kind of cases that you see most often and that you operate on?
The incidence of the conditions that we can treat varies from 1 in 1,000 to very rare 1 in 30,000 pregnancies, for example. And the number of patients that we can treat actually depends also on the success of the surgeries. Because the success of the surgeries is most commonly with twins, with identical twins that are sharing the same placenta, that is one of the most common conditions that we treat. But we also treat babies, for example, with obstruction of the bladder when the baby cannot urinate in utero, or when there is a defect, there's a hole in the diaphragm and the organs of the abdomen go to the chest and other conditions, different types of conditions. So the most common conditions that we treat are complications of identical twins when they share the same placenta, and they have different types of problems from that.
Wow. Et Jean-Luc, tu as dit, et ou pas obligé couper ventre là pour faire opération ça yo, et ou aller rentrer et puis avec un aiguille rentrer et puis ou faire opération normalement. Et c'est plus monde qui jumeau qui censé avec placenta qui partage même placenta qui ont des complications ça, mais bien que ont des problèmes tout et so on. You're talking about twins. How about multiple birth, triplets? Is that very common as well?
Actually, it can also happen in triplets. We have treated patients where all three babies are sharing the same placenta. That is extremely rare, extremely rare. But in some of those cases, when they are all sharing the same placenta, and they can have different types of complications that, unless we treat them before birth, can result in loss of the pregnancy.
We will be showing a video, but can you take us step by step the procedure that you do?
The procedures that we do are done under local anesthesia. One of the most important principles of any of the surgeries that we do is to do it in a what we call minimally invasive fashion. Minimally invasive means that we use local anesthesia and that we use very small instruments, because we have to go inside the womb to do the surgery that we need to do, and then we have to come out and the pregnancy has to continue. If we use large instruments or we open the mother the way it used to be done before I developed these surgeries, then you always have the risk of losing the pregnancy even if you were able to correct the problem. So what we do is a minimally invasive approach, local anesthesia, a very, very small instrument, the diameter of a pencil maybe, or even less than a pencil. We go inside the womb through the mother's abdomen, through the skin, through the womb, into the bag of waters, sometimes inside the baby if we have to operate inside the baby, for example. We do the surgery that we need to do. We use a camera that is attached to the instrument, to the endoscope. It's like a telescope that is attached to a camera. And when we're done, then we pull out the instrument, and the uterus closes behind where we went in. It closes the muscle, and so the bag of waters doesn't break, it remains intact, and the pregnancy continues, and she can have a baby, sometimes even at term.
If you have a tumor, let's say, which is a, maybe, you know, this size, so if you make a small hole to go to get the needle, but how do you get that tumor out to that hole?
If there is a tumor, which is a very rare condition, we don't have to get the tumor out.
Ah.
We just have to cut it off the baby, for example. So let's say it's a tumor, we operated on a
baby mouth,
where the tumor was attached to the mouth. All we need to do is cut the tumor off of the baby so that the tumor doesn't harm the baby, doesn't kill the baby, and the baby, you know, the pregnancy continues. It doesn't affect the pregnancy. The tumor, once it's cut off the baby and is left inside the pregnancy, dies because it doesn't have any blood supply.
Ah, wow, interesting. You know, you think that if you leave it in there, maybe it might attach somewhere and then just go, but that makes sense. If you cut it and no blood supply, it dies. So
it just stays there.
That is. Yeah. Anybody in the country does this procedure as well? I know in LA they have some of this in LA as well. Is there any part of the country besides Miami?
We have trained other doctors in the United States and also outside of the United States. We work in collaboration with our partner in Los Angeles. We have the same technology, the same techniques, and the same outcomes. There are other centers in the country that have also, you know, develop their programs. They have different technology and different outcomes also, but there are other centers in the country as well.
Most of the prognosis obviously is favorable. Is there any cases in the past that have not been too successful because of some complications?
Well, actually, the history of what we have developed is quite interesting, because rarely do you see in medicine in general a situation where you have basically flipped the coin on something. Okay? Before we started to do these surgeries, for example, 90% of the pregnancies of twins, identical twins, that had these complications of uneven blood exchange, for example, through the placenta, would be lost. 90%. Today, 90% of the pregnancies are saved by the surgery. So it's literally, you know, a total flip of the coin on the prognosis for these pregnancies today. And so the same thing is happening with the other conditions that we treat, for example, bladder obstruction. If you don't treat bladder obstruction in the womb, 90% of the babies survive. If we treat bladder obstruction today with a shunt that I developed and the technique that I developed, 90% of the babies survive. You see what I'm saying? So it's quite an interesting chapter as a whole. If you take the history of medicine, the entire history of medicine as a whole, how you can change the prognosis on a condition. Of course, we have examples like that in, let's say, pre-antibiotic era and antibiotic era. If you had pneumonia before antibiotics, you know, you had a very high chance that you would die. With antibiotics, you almost have 100% chance you can survive. So these are the kinds of examples that we like to share with colleagues and patients in terms of the outlook of the kinds of surgeries that we perform. But it all hinges on adhering to very, very fundamental principles. Disturb the pregnancy the least and do as much as you can to treat the condition so that you address the problem but you don't create a problem from the surgery itself.
This is very, very impressive. You know, it's amazing that going through the training in medical school, that you actually, in your residency, that you actually came up with something that can help save thousands of lives and babies. So we really appreciate it. We are proud of you as a physician, as a surgeon. Is there any last word that you'd like to share with our viewers?
Well, first of all, I appreciate very much the opportunity to be in your program and the opportunity to address your audience, because they need to know that there is hope. We don't say that we can save all the babies or that we can cure the babies. We can offer them hope. There is hope for their pregnancies. If they want to treat the baby in the womb, if there is a complication that can be treated, we can help them. Of course, you know, it's up to the patient to decide to proceed or not proceed with treatment. But if they choose to, you know, treat the baby before birth because that's what's needed, we are here to help.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, nous avons avec nous et Madame Tanina Goldman, qui parle créole haïtienne, qui est office manager dans Phyto Institute là. Nous pourrons faire un petit parler avec lui pour lui expliquer nous créole, ouais, mais qui ça fait ici là et pour ça choisi pour participer dans un gros programme ça et que deux docteurs ça va faire beau ici là. Mrs. Goldman, bonjour.
Bonjour.
Ou bien bonsoir.
Oui.
Et qui ça fait ici là de Phyto Institute?
Eh bien, le patient au relais ou que un docteur relais, moi contacter patient directement pour tout document yo, relais docteur prend document laboratoire pour que docteur qui situe ka révisé yo pour yo ka wè patient. Gade le me contacter assurance, contacter docteur qui voye yo et avec obi docteur parce que il y a toujours deux docteurs, il y a spécialiste yo qui voye yo ba nous. Et docteur que yo wè chaque mois pendant yon set.
Ki ka ke wè ke nou wè pi souvent ici là. Et docteur t'a parlé que c'est plus monde qui gagne jumeaux. Et est-ce que c'est ça?
Oui, nous avons jumeaux et triplets aussi qui ont le même problème, non? Qui est le TTTS, Transfusion Syndrome.
Expliquez-moi ce que ça, ça veut dire.
Ça veut dire.
Infirmière.
Ça veut dire que vous avez deux bébés. Et deux ou trois bébés, et il y a un bébé qui vraiment absorbe l'autre. Là. Donc, il faut une intervention pour que vous puissiez réserver tous les deux bébés. Yo. Vraiment, c'est la définition du problème. Là.
Qui ça, docteur, fait même?
Vous faites transfusion. Pour, et toujours, il y a un bébé qui est plus gros et un bébé qui est plus petit. Donc, pipiti avec pigouan, yon abgouman l'autre pour yon jouen toute nutrition que yon besoin. Donc, c'est ça yon fait. Yon gede le yon fait une transfusion. Gede le yon fait un bail dans le cordon ombilical bébé. Hein? Puis yon ka, tous les deux bébés ka survi.
Ah, et son bail qui est normal, c'est pas, yon pas obligé de couper ventre là.
Non, non, si yon incision tout petit, yon pas besoin de mettre patient non plus. Son anesthésie locale, il y a des patients. Il y a des patients qui comprennent que quoi font une grosse chirurgie, que sang. Non, nous pas fait ça.
Et parfois, tout docteur qui retire la tumeur tout, et la bouche ou bien côté lien, mais c'est qui rentre, mais ça arrive tout.
Oui, ça arrive.
Et depuis, vous coupez la tumeur là, et donc, vous pas de problème, donc la tumeur pas grossi pour bâtir bébé, aucun problème.
Non. Il y a un petit bébé qui a une tumeur, il y a un petit bébé qui a une bladder obstruction, bowel obstruction. Donc, il met un shot pour bébé. Hein. C'est comme si que ou pas qu'à éliminer l'urine. Donc, à ce moment-là, depuis bébé en de votre maman, il a réglé ça et le bébé en sorti, il y a un team qui vient qui prend bébé en main.
OK. Donc c'est pas patient qui relè ici directement. C'est référal par un docteur qui vient. Oh. Donc si patient besoin relè, est-ce que ka relè ou bien c'est docteur qui peut voyer?
Il y a des patients qui relè, nous gen patients qui sont de Pérou, Équateur, Venezuela, yo relè directement. Nous gon website, nan fè recherche yo, le gon problème yo joine nous. Yo joine nous, yo relè directement et là ça le relè, moi fè rendez-vous pour yo, me parle à docteur. Moi dit que il a venir avec tout papier pour nous ca réviser et voyer pour nous docteur réviser pour essayer à plan ca.
Madame Goldman, si gain maman enceinte qui a problème avec petit bébé ou que c'est jumeau yoyé ou bien si on gain complication, qui côté ca reler pour yo reler pour rendez-vous pour docteur consulter yo?
Yo ca reler ici là directement. Et 786-971-2303.
Que vous parlez créole, que vous parlez ouémé, ou après pour nous
vous parlez créole, que vous parlez français, anglais, nous parlez grec, nous parlez espagnol, nous après pour téléphone et nous aider.
Ok, qui website là?
TheFiddleInstitute.com. Le grand website, vous pouvez regarder pour qui sa docteur fait, qui spécialisation docteur.
Ok. Well, et merci pour le vœu. Et je vous remercie pour une bonne information. Et Jean et Madame Goldman ont dit si nous sommes enceintes et puis nous avons des problèmes, complications avec les bébés, c'est ici temps pour nous relayer, on met pour nous faire ça pour nous. Nous avons avec nous Shina Nicolas, qui est un patient de l'Amphito Institute. Là, et nous, il est très gentil. Nous pouvons poser une question pour qui ça que choisir pour venir dans Fit Institute là. She's from Sarasota and she came all the way from Sarasota to be here. Shina, I'd like to welcome you to the show.
Bonjour.
Bonjour. Very good. She's Haitian, but you know her Creole is not 100%, but she's able to communicate some of that, you know. So why did you decide to come to the Fit Institute?
I was seen by maternal fetal medicine and I was told that I have amniotic band syndrome.
Can you explain it to the people to see exactly how they found this out? And how many weeks are you?
I'm 16 weeks.
16 now. Weeks. But your stomach doesn't look like, you know. Okay.
There.
Living 4 months enceinte. Et les gros petits problèmes, et bébé gros petits problèmes que docteur li diagnose. Donc, il vient ici là et pour voir si docteur ka aider li. Can you explain to the people exactly what is that syndrome?
What happens is that with the fluid that the baby's inside of, the amniotic fluid that it's living in, sometimes, which is a rare case, it affects 1 in 15,000 kids, is what I've learned. It attaches to the baby and it could potentially cut off a limb of the baby. And so what they do here is they help to actually remove those bands so that you can have a successful pregnancy and that the baby is okay.
Are you, how are you feeling? Is that affecting you as a mother at all right now?
No.
No. Do you feel any symptoms or you just feel like a normal pregnancy?
Normal pregnancy.
How did the doctor, your OBGYN, how did you find this out?
They did ultrasound and they were able to see the bands on the baby's leg and wrist.
Ouè, koun yon la gen teknoloji, kote ke lò fè yon ultrasyon vreman e bò kòz problem lan si ti pe bien normal ou men pa normal. Lan kali an, yon fè li, yon wè ke gon bagay ki pa normal, se sa ke fè e ke li deside vini sit lan. How did you find out about this place?
My doctor recommended me to come here. They're very, very, very well-renowned, this office, and the staff member actually used to work here and she spoke great things about this place.
Okay, and this is your first visit today?
Yes.
Okay, you saw the doctor already?
Yes.
And then what's the next step?
They're going to likely look into removing those bands. And they presented a bunch of different options, but they are able to actually minimally invasively go inside and remove the bands so that the baby can be free of them and continue to develop.
And this is your first pregnancy, or do you have any other babies?
First pregnancy.
Mm-hmm. So it had to happen with the first one, huh?
Yeah.
Will that make you hesitant to become pregnant again, or you know, are you just? I mean, this is something that happened. You proceed, and then you know, you go to the next baby in the future.
Dr. Quintero explained that it doesn't affect next pregnancies or anything like that moving forward. So it's just one of those things that just happens. It's never anything that the parent did.
Okay, well, you know, we thank you for your time, and you look beautiful as a pregnant lady, you know, and I have no doubt that you're going to have a wonderful and healthy baby.
Thank you.
Thank you. Eh bien, c'était Sheena Nicolas, et un patient qui vient de Sarasota, l'amphithéâtre de l'Institut là, et pour lui, et je suis une solution pour un petit bébé, il y a 4 mois enceinte, un petit bébé a un gros problème, et un bande cap pesé lui. Et avec l'opération qu'il a fait pour ici, il y a des petits bébés normaux, et il y a des choses pour pas que nous continuions normal. Donc, je vous remercie nous pour la patience. Nous. Et je souhaite que nous apprenions plus bas aujourd'hui, hein, la gauche que nous gagnons soit accentée. Nous sommes dans le wedding room Fito Institute. Là, et nous regardons la mûre, nous avons une photo de petits bébés qui fait. Après que vous faites opération pour vous. Et les parents sont tellement contents du résultat, vous voyez une photo frame pour le docteur pour dire merci en pile. Ça, par exemple, il marque tout le Dream Team. Thank you for saving our lives. We are internally grateful. Love, Sharon et Makayela. Petit bébé, ça a été fait le 19 juillet 2010 à 36 semaines. Ça, nous avons l'autre caméra en cale. Qui fait May 31st, 2012. Deux jumeaux qui fait qu'il y a un problème, le été en devant maman, qu'on y a là, je regarde là, il y a santé qu'on y a là. Ça même, c'est triplette. C'est trois petits mouns qui sont ensemble, qui sont devant maman, qui ont un problème. Ils ont fait opération pour qu'on y a là, petit bébé, ils ont fait normalement, qu'on y a là, ils ont en santé. Et puis avec trois autres exemples encore qu'on y a là. On dirait ça, c'est haïtien, parce que moi, Josia, et Keno Saint-Ville. Donc, ce sont deux jumeaux haïtiens qui étaient là, qui étaient un problème. Et ils ont fait opération pour Kounia là, Tim Yovin Grand Kounia là. Et il n'y a pas marqué qui date que ont été faites, mais seulement Kounia là, je pensais que Kounia là, Tim Yovin Grand Kounia là. Donc, c'est un exemple qui a fait l'Amphitho Institute là.